Hello, welcome to La Excellence. Welcome to La Ex Prelims Marathon session. In this session, we are going to discuss 12 important environmental conventions that are in use. The PDF of this session is available in the description box. Please check the link. Now let's start the discussion. These are the 12 important conventions that we are going to discuss today. Before that, let me clarify few words to you. First one, convention. What is the meaning of convention? All the member countries meet here and they give the broader guidelines. Okay, they agree for broader guidelines. And then there are certain words called protocol. Protocol means after coming to a particular understanding under a convention, how to implement them, there should be some specific guidelines. So for providing specific guidelines, we have protocols. And then we also listen to these words called ratification, signing, ratify and sign. These are two important words that we often hear with regard to environmental conventions. When a convention is there, the countries sign first. After that, when they implement the provisions of the convention, they ratify it. Ratification means agreeing to implement. Sign means agreeing to be part of that. That's it. If we sign, we need not implement it. Only when we ratify a convention, we try to implement it. Remember these three keywords. These are very important in understanding various aspects. And there's one more word called COP, Conference of Parties. Conference of Parties means, in general, the member countries are called as parties to the conference. So this is a decision-making body. Each convention has a conference of parties. They meet frequently, maybe once for 2 years or every year or once for 3 years. Likewise, they meet and they take decisions. That's about COP. Okay, now let us start the discussion. Let us start with United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification. The first important convention is UNCCD, that is United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification. See, there is this summit in 1992 called Earth Summit. Under this Earth Summit, all the world countries who have participated in this summit, they have agreed for three important conventions. First one is UNFCC, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Second one is United Nations Convention on Biodiversity. Third one is United Nations Convention on Combating Desertification, CCD. These three were proposed during that time. And UNCCD is effective from 1994. There are 197 member countries. 197 member countries under this convention. What are the objectives of this convention? This is to combat desertification and mitigate. Mitigate means decline or decrease the effects of a drought and desertification through various local, national and international measures. Is it legally binding or not? What is the meaning of legally binding? Legally binding means if someone ratifies a convention, they have to follow the guidelines given over there. That's the meaning of legal binding. Yes, this is a legally binding convention. Due to global warming, climate change, the process of desertification is increasing. Not just in India, but worldwide, the desertification process is increasing. In that context, we want to reverse that trend. Every year, June 17th is observed as World Day to Combat the Desertification and Drought. There are many national measures that each country have to take under this UNCCD. India is part of that. India, for the first time, has hosted the 14th session of COP. COP means what? The members. So, the 14th session of COP was hosted by India last year. The theme of the conference was Restore Land and Sustain Future. Restore the land which is under desertification or which is prone to drought. Right, let us understand few important facts regarding India's desertification and how we want to restore our degraded land, etc. If we consider the total area, 29% of total geographical area of India is under land degradation. Right? 29%. Understand. Now we want to restore it.
Initially in 2015, we said we are going to restore 21 million hectares of land by 2030. But recently when this UNCCD was held in India, we have revised our target and we are going to restore 26 million hectares of land. How? Through afforestation, water resource management, sustainable agricultural practices. In these ways, we are going to restore our land. Last year, when we held this COP14 in India, India has accepted this challenge known as Bonn Challenge. Bonn Challenge is to reverse the land desertification or land degradation. So India accepted Bonn Challenge and we said, yes, we are going to restore 26 million hectares of our land. See, total 96 million hectares land is degraded. Now we want to restore 26 million hectares of land by when? By 2030. Here we need to know this one single point. This year's 17th June, that is World Day to Combat Desertification, is celebrated, and the theme of this is sustainable production and consumption. This is the theme of this year's World Day on Combating Desertification. One very important area that we should know with regard to prelims is, what are the outcomes of COP14? COP14 was held in India in New Delhi. And we have adopted New Delhi Declaration. In New Delhi Declaration, what are the important takeaways? That can be the prelims question. See, land restoration is the cheapest solution to climate change biodiversity loss. Land restoration makes business sense if we have better regulations, etc. Drought preparedness, response. These are two important critical phases of climate change. People first approach should be followed. These are the important areas discussed under New Delhi Declaration. New Delhi Declaration, UNCCD, UNCCD COP14, New Delhi. The next important convention is Bonn Convention, which is also called as CMS, Convention on Migratory Species. CMS is the name of Bonn Convention. This was ratified in the year 1983. 129 member countries are part of this convention. What are the objectives of this convention? It is to conserve the migratory species within their migratory ranges. To conserve them, this convention has been undertaken. Is it legally binding? No, it's not legally binding. What is the speciality of this one? It is the only global convention which covers terrestrial animals, aquatic animals, avian migratory species. All spheres of species are covered under this particular convention, Bonn Convention, which is also called as CMS. Why is this in news? Because the COP 13 of Bonn Convention was held in India this year. That's why this was in news. Right, let us understand this. Conservation of migratory species of wild animals. This COP is the decision-making body for this convention. In this CMS, we have two important lists. We call them as Appendix 1 and Appendix 2. Appendix 1 deals with the species, migratory species, which are under extinction or which have the threat of extinction. Appendix 2 deals with other migratory species. Recently, we said COP 13, Conference of Parties 13, was held in India. Yes or no? So this 13th COP convention was held in Gujarat, Gandhinagar, this year, 22nd February 2020, right? India is party to Convention on Migratory Species since 1983. Since its inception, India is party to this convention. What is the theme of this year's COP 13? That is, migratory species connect the planet and we welcome them home. We welcome them home. That is the theme of this particular convention. And mascot of the CMS COP 13 is Gibby. Gibby means Great Indian Bustard. Very, very important. Great Indian Bustard. It is critically endangered species. IUCN has given critically endangered species list. And India's Wildlife Protection Act is protecting this particular species under Schedule 1. Remember this point. The Great Indian Bustard, these are famous. These are commonly found in Western India, Northwestern India, because these species, they require grasslands, so scrub grasslands, etc. These species can be found loss of habitat is one of the major reasons for increasing vulnerability to these species. Next, what are the takeaways of COP13? During COP13, we have adopted Gandhinagar Declaration. Remember, UNCCD is in Delhi. COP14, New Delhi Declaration. This one, CMS, is in Gandhinagar. COP13, Gandhinagar Declaration. This has called for this protection of migratory species, and there is this concept called ecological connectivity. Ecological connectivity in what? In biodiversity conservation. If we want to conserve our species, we need to conserve the entire ecosystem. That is the concept of ecological connectivity. So this Gandhinagar Declaration emphasizes on that. What should be our post-2020 agenda? That will be decided in this China's Kunming Summit that is going to be held in October 2020, COP15 of CMS, Convention on Migratory Species. There were certain species that are added to the various appendices. We have Appendix 1 and Appendix 2 under this, yes or no? Under that, 7 species, namely Asian elephant, jaguar, great Indian bustard, Bengal floricon, little bustard, antipodean, oceanic white-tipped shark, these are added to Appendix 1. That means they are highly threatened. And this provides for strict protection for these species. We need to remember this list. They might ask which of the following are protected under the recently concluded the CMS in India. What are the other takeaways from this convention? In the Indian subcontinent is part of major bird flyway network. Bird flyway network means there are many birds which migrate from one place to another place. Their regular path is called as flyway network. That network that is going through India is called Central Asian Flyway. The Central Asian Flyway, this connects Arctic to Indian Ocean. So in winters, birds migrate from Arctic to Indian Ocean region. So we have this National Action Plan for the Conservation of Migratory Species under Central Asian Flyway. We have launched during this COP13, we have launched this National Action Plan for Conservation of Migratory Species. And then India has also pledged focus on conservation of migratory birds along the Central Asian Flyway and announced an institution and a research agency to protect them. That's about COP13, Gandhinagar Declaration. Now let us discuss the another convention. The third important convention in news is Ramsar Convention. Ramsar is a name in Iran. So the world countries have signed this convention in Iran's Ramsar city. That's why the convention is named as Ramsar Convention. It is effective from 1975. There are 171 member countries under this convention. The objective of this convention is for conservation and sustainable use of wetlands. There is this concept called wise use of wetlands. What is this wise use? Wise use means, yes, we need to use these services and the products of the environment and the wetland, but we should use them wisely. We should not over exploit them. That's the meaning of wise use of resources. Is it legally binding? No. And remember, this is the first and only global treaty for the conservation of a specific ecosystem called wetland ecosystem. This is the only convention. What is the significance of CMS? Convention on Biodiversity or Bonn Convention, that covers three territorial, aerial and marine migratory species. That's its own specialty. And Ramsar is particular ecosystem. One single ecosystem is conserved under this particular convention. Earlier we had 27 Ramsar sites in India. Now last year we have added 10 more Ramsar sites. So this is the list of 27 important Ramsar sites in India. These are the 10 important Ramsar sites that are declared recently. So please remember them. This can be a question in our prelims. Which of the following are the recently declared wetlands in India? Remember, in Punjab, UP and Maharashtra, in these three states, new wetlands are declared. Nangal Wildlife Sanctuary of Punjab, Keshapur Wetland of Punjab, Bias Wetland of Punjab. In UP, Sarsi Navar Jheel, Navabhanj Bird Sanctuary, Samshapur Bird Sanctuary, Sandhi Bird Sanctuary, Parvati Arga Bird Sanctuary, Saman Bird Sanctuary. These are from UP. And from Maharashtra, Nandur Madhyameshwar Bird Sanctuary. These are the 10 newly added Ramsar wetlands in India. There is a record called Montreux Record. Montreux Record, which is maintained under Ramsar Convention. This Montreux Record maintains the highly threatened wetlands across the world. The next important convention is Vienna Convention. Vienna Convention is for the protection of ozone layer. This is effective from the year 1985. 197 member countries of UN, United Nations, are members of the are members of this convention. Remember, most of the conventions that we are discussing and we are going to discuss are part of UNEP, United Nations Environmental Program. This is a specific body under United Nations which oversees the environmental protection around the world. Okay, what are the objectives of Vienna Convention? It provides the international framework for the reductions in the production of chlorofluorocarbons. Why? These chlorofluorocarbons are called ozone depleting substances, ODS. As these are ozone depleting substances, this Vienna Convention provides a framework on how to reduce the use of them. Is it legally binding? No. Any country can move out. Any country can sign and not implement it. That's their own choice. Okay. See, every year, 16th September is observed as World Ozone Day. And this year, because of the lockdown in many countries, the ozone hole and the release of ozone depleting substances has reduced. That point we should remember. And ground ozone is the new issue that is in news. Ground ozone. What is ground ozone? Tropospheric ozone is called as ground ozone. That is bad for us. That is harmful to the humans as well as the animals. Next is Montreal Protocol. Montreal Protocol is not a convention. This is part of Vienna Convention. Under Vienna Convention, we said these are the things that we need to do, broader objectives. Under Montreal Protocol, we provide specific guidelines or specific rules on how to achieve these targets set under the convention. Montreal Protocol also deals with ozone depletion. This came into effect in the year 1987. 197 member countries are part of it. This is to protect the ozone layer by phasing out, means by removing the production of numerous substances which are called as ozone depleting substances. Is it legally binding? Yes, this is legally binding. Recently, there is an amendment to Montreal Protocol through this Kigali Agreement. Kigali Agreement in 2016, this has amended the Montreal Protocol, and this has become effective from 2019. That's why this is in news. Here is the list of what are HFCs, hydrofluorocarbons, what are the various aspects that are agreed under Kigali Agreement. Please go through it once, very very important in your environment. We can expect 20 to 25 questions from environment subject in our prelims. So carefully read various topics and go through this image. This is very very important. HFCs is the focus of Kigali Agreement, which is effective from last year, that is 2019. The next important convention that is in news is Minamata Convention. This is a convention on mercury under United Nations Environmental Program. This is effective from the year 2013. There are total 140 member countries. This is to protect the human health and the environment from mercury and mercury-related pollution and mercury-related components. Is this legally binding? Yes, legally binding. This convention is named after the city Minamata. Why? Because due to mercury pollution, so many people got this disease. Many people has got the disease called Blue Baby Syndrome in this particular area. That is why the convention's name is Minamata Convention. Blue Baby Syndrome is the effect of mercury pollution. Very, very important. The next important convention in news is Stockholm Convention. This convention is on persistent organic pollutant, POP. This is effective from 2001, and there are total 152 member countries. What are the objectives? It is to eliminate or to restrict the production and use of what? Use of POPs, persistent organic pollutants. This is legally binding. In all these conventions, India is a member. Remember, whatever conventions that we have studied till now and that we are going to read from now on, in all these conventions, India is a member. Yes, what are the other important points? Global Environmental Facility provides funding for this particular convention for the implementation of Stockholm Convention. Right, there is this term called dirty dozen. Dirty dozen means 12 important organic pollutants which pollute the land, air and water. These are persistent organic pollutants. What are these 12? These 12 are called dirty dozen. Endrin is one such. See, endrin is used for what? Agriculture, yes or no? So likewise, DDTs, and there are many pesticides in this list of 12. So banning them completely is not viable. So finding an alternative to these chemicals is the alternative that the governments are taking. But overall, dirty dozen means 12 persistent organic pollutants. The next important convention is Rotterdam Convention. Rotterdam Convention was effective from 1998. There are 72 member countries. This promotes shared responsibility. This is a very important word. Rotterdam Convention promotes shared responsibility in relation to import of hazardous chemicals. Is this legally binding? Yes, legally binding. Let's say from Australia, if we are importing some chemical, or from China, if we are importing some chemical, then we need to have a prior informed consent procedure for certain hazardous chemicals. For example, pesticides, etc. They need to have prior information for what purpose they are going to use it. That way, for shared responsibility of the buyer and seller, Rotterdam Convention provides certain rules and guidelines. The next important convention which is related to Rotterdam Convention is Bonn Convention. See, under UNCCD, combating desertification, what we have read is Bonn Challenge. Bonn is a place. So, Bonn Challenge. Here, Bonn Convention. Now, Bonn Convention was effective from 1989. Only 53 member countries are part of it. And this convention is designed to reduce the movement of hazardous waste between countries, significantly to prevent the transfer of hazardous waste from developed countries to less developed countries. Most of the developed countries are dumping their waste in underdeveloped countries or less developed countries. So to reduce that movement, Bessel Convention is proposed. Remember, our Rotterdam Convention is for what? Rotterdam Convention is on importing the chemicals, right? Importing or exporting the chemical components. But Bessel Convention is to reduce the movement of hazardous waste. It is to reduce the movement of hazardous waste. See, last year, 14th Bessel Convention was held in Geneva, which has laid down the guidelines on hazardous waste. In last year, May 2019, it was held. One of the important outcome of this convention is that it has included plastic waste in legally binding framework. This is a legally binding framework. So it has included plastic waste under this convention. That means a developed country cannot, without any permission, without proper care, cannot dump the plastic waste in another LDC. So that's how it has added. But remember, radioactive waste is not part of this convention. Radioactive waste is not covered under this particular convention. The next important environmental convention is CITES. The Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Flora and Fauna. So this is effective from 1973. 183 member countries are part of it. It is to protect the endangered plants and species. This is legally binding agreement. Although CITES is a legally binding agreement, it does not take the place of national laws. That means if there is any national law already mentioned, that is not overridden with this convention. For example, in India, we have Wildlife Protection Act. Yes or no? Wildlife Protection Act 1972 is there. this CITES is not going to override the provisions of Wildlife Protection Act. That is the meaning of this. Why this is the news? Because last year COP18 was held in Geneva. COP18 of CITES convention was held in Geneva. During that time, India, Nepal, Bangladesh, we have requested the CITES committee to move the smooth coated otter from appendix 2 to appendix 1. Appendix 1, 2, 3, these are three lists that are mentioned under this convention. And then Indian star tortoise was moved to appendix 1. Very, very important. Smooth coated otter and star tortoise, these are moved to appendix 1. And Toki gecko is included under CITES appendix 2. What are these? What is appendix 1? What is appendix 2? What is appendix 3 under the CITES convention? Appendix 1 means species threatened with extinction. So under CITES convention, it completely bans the commercial trade of these species. Appendix 2 means lower level of protection. Appendix 3 means protected at least in one country, need not be protected in all countries. So this is full protection, this is partial protection, and appendix 2 normal protection. So that is how CITES 3 appendices are there. Recently smooth coated otter and this Indian star tortoise were added to this appendix 1 of COP18 during COP18. The next important convention is Convention on Biodiversity. Why this was the news? Because of this COVID-19, we need to protect the biodiversity. Otherwise, we are going to get the zoonotic disease. These are the arguments. So, for zoonotic diseases, to reduce them, conserving biodiversity is the only solution. That is being told by many environmentalists. In that context, we need to know about Convention on Biodiversity. So, this is also proposed under which summit? Earth Summit, Rio Summit, you remember? 1992. There are 196 member countries. This is to develop national strategies for conservation and sustainable use of biological diversity. Is it legally binding? Yes, it is legally binding. In 2021, Convention on Biodiversity Summit is going to be held in Kunming area of China. COP15 is going to be in Kunming area of China. The last convention in this particular session is UNFCCC. UNFCCC, this is effective from the year 1992. There are 165 member countries. 165 member countries. Earlier 197 member countries signed, but few countries have moved out of it. What are the objectives of this convention? To reduce the concentration of greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases. Because these greenhouse gases, they cause the climate change. That is why reducing the atmospheric concentration of greenhouse gases is the objective of UNFCCC. It is not legally binding. COP25 was held last year in Spain, that is Madrid. Remember UNFCCC COP24, 24th meeting of Conference of Parties to United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. 24th convention was held in Katowice, Poland. And 25th COP was held in Madrid in the year 2019. See, it has to be held in Chile. But due to the protests and domestic concerns of Chile, Spain said we will conduct it. So that's how in Spain's Madrid city, COP25 was held. With regard to Katowice summit, that is COP24, we need to remember this rule called Katowice rule. Katowice rule means what are we going to do after 2020? We have Paris climate change deal or Paris agreement. So how are we going to implement the provisions mentioned under that Paris agreement? That is the question now. For that, all the leaders, all the people under COP24 met at this place called Katowice. So that's where they have adopted this rule called Katowice rule. And last year COP25, it was concluded in Madrid. But no substantive outcomes from this summit. Right, along with this, we need to know about few things which are very important. Last year, these are the summits that our Prime Minister has attended. And there are two important summits. Let us understand about them. 74th session of United Nations General Assembly. During that session, there's a special session called United Nations Climate Action Summit. Under that summit, our Prime Minister has announced for universal health coverage. Our Prime Minister has announced for various measures, including this one. India and Sweden together have announced leadership group for industry transition. Leadership group for industry transition to guide the world's heaviest greenhouse gas emitting countries like India. See, India's per capita emissions are less, but overall contributions of GHGs are more. We come in third place after USA and China. In the same summit, our Prime Minister has proposed for coalition for disaster resilient infrastructure. There will be many countries who will coordinate with regard to climate resilient and disaster resilient infrastructure. And there's this another convention or another assembly which was held in Kenya, Nairobi, United Nations Environment Assembly. So this was held for the fourth time. The theme of United Nations Environmental Assembly is innovative solutions for environmental challenges and sustainable consumption and production. That's the theme. All the countries unanimously agreed for cutting down the use of plastic cups, cutlery, bags, etc. Along with this summit, United Nations Environment Programme launched this particular report called Global Environment Outlook Report. Very, very important. Who launched Global Environment Outlook Report? That is United Nations Environment Programme. With regard to tiger conservation, there is this International Stock Taking Conference on Tiger Conservation. This is the third International Stock Taking Conference on Tiger Conservation. It is related to Global Tiger Recovery Program. This was held in New Delhi last year. This conference was held by National Tiger Conservation Authority under Ministry of Forest Climate Change. So this is in collaboration with the Global Tiger Forum. We should remember this. We have got into Guinness Book record for setting up many camera traps to calculate the tigers under our tiger census. Tiger census is done by NTCA, National Tiger Conservation Authority. These are the important conventions and issues that we should remember for our prelims 2020. If you have any queries, questions with regard to this session, please let us know in the comment section. All the very best. Thank you very much.